Welcome to our Mystery Sleep Stories channel, your sanctuary for meditation and a peaceful sleep. Immerse yourself in the soothing embrace of sleep-inducing tales, carefully crafted to transport you to mysterious lands. Let the gentle rain and serene sounds of nature accompany you on this quest for deep sleep. Say goodbye to restless nights and welcome the embrace of a restful sleep with our mystery bedtime stories. So, let the tale begin. Overnight in the medieval Scottish castle. Chapter 1. Arrival at the castle. Ethan's journey to the Scottish Highlands was marked by a mixture of anticipation and awe as the landscape around him transformed from bustling city streets to the serene, rugged beauty of ancient land. As he traveled further north, the modern world seemed to peel away, leaving behind layers of history exposed like the rocks on the mountainsides. His destination, a medieval castle perched majestically on a rocky outcrop, was steeped in legends and stories of yore, a place where the past was palpable in the very air he breathed. The castle, known as Dunmarag, was an imposing structure, its towers and battlements outlined against the brooding Scottish sky. It had stood sentinel over the surrounding lands for centuries, surviving countless battles and sieges, its stones bearing the scars of history. The road to Dunmarag wound through dense forests and along the edge of a mist-shrouded loch, the water's surface mirroring the dramatic shifts of the Scottish weather. As Ethan's car approached the castle's main gate, he was struck by the sheer scale of the architecture. Towering walls of rough-hewn stone, massive wooden doors bound with iron, and narrow windows that had once allowed archers to defend the fortress. It was like driving into a different era. The modern world seemed suddenly trivial in comparison to the ancient majesty of Dunmarag. Mr. MacGregor, the castle keeper, was waiting for Ethan at the entrance. He was a burly man, clad in a tartan kilt and a thick woolen sweater that seemed to swallow his substantial frame. His beard, peppered with gray, was as unruly as the Highland wilderness, and his eyes twinkled with a mix of mischief and warmth. "Welcome to Dunmarag," he boomed in a voice that seemed to echo off the castle walls. "You've picked a fine night to hear the tales of old." The main doors creaked ominously as they opened, revealing the castle's grand entry hall. The hall was lit by torches set in iron sconces along the walls, casting flickering shadows that danced across the stone floor. The air was cool and damp, with the scent of peat smoke lingering from fires long extinguished. The walls were lined with ancient weapons and faded tapestries that told stories of the castle's illustrious past. Battles won and lost, alliances forged and broken, and lairds, whose stern faces were immortalized in oil paintings, now darkened with age. Mr. MacGregor led Ethan through the entry hall into the heart of the castle, his heavy boots echoing on the stone. "This castle has stood for over 700 years," he explained, his voice a blend of pride and reverence. "Each stone here tells a story, and if you listen closely enough, you might just hear them whisper." Their steps took them through shadowy corridors, lined with armor stands and more tapestries. Each corridor leading to another part of the castle's complex layout. The air grew colder as they descended a narrow spiral staircase to the castle's dungeons. now empty but for the echoes of the past. The walls here were damp and mossy, the atmosphere thick with the heavy weight of history. Chains hung from the walls, and in the dim light, Ethan could make out the outlines of cells that had once held prisoners of war, and perhaps even the occasional misbehaving laird. Climbing back up to the main level, they passed through the great hall, where a grand feast might have once welcomed a king or celebrated a victory. Now it stood silent, the long oak table bare, except for a few candles that cast a soft, golden light across its surface. Mr. MacGregor gestured towards the high, vaulted ceiling, where faded frescoes depicted the celestial dance of sun, moon, and stars. A homage to the Highland belief in the intertwining of earthly and celestial fates. Finally, they arrived at the residential quarters where Ethan would spend the night. The room was surprisingly cozy for such an austere setting, with a large four-poster bed, a roaring fire in the hearth, and heavy drapes that blocked out the cold wind. A small table by the window held a pitcher of water and a bowl of fresh fruit, a simple yet welcoming gesture. "As you settle in," Mr. MacGregor said, handing Ethan a large iron key, "remember that tonight the walls may speak to you of ancient times. Dun Morag is very much alive with the spirits of those who've walked these halls before ye. Listen, and you'll learn much." With a nod and a mysterious smile, he left Ethan alone with the thick stone walls and the crackling fire, the night's shadows weaving their silent tales around him. As the sun set completely, leaving the world outside blanketed in darkness, Ethan felt a stirring of something deep and ancient in the air around him. The castle, with its centuries of history, seemed to come alive in the twilight. Tonight, he was not just a visitor, but a part of Dunmorag's long narrative, a living witness to its continuing story. The night promised to be one of discovery and connection, a journey back in time where the past was as real as the present, and every shadow held a story. Chapter 2, The Banquet Hall. After the echoing footsteps of Mr. MacGregor faded away, Ethan stood alone at the threshold of the grand banquet hall. The air inside the chamber was cool and tinged with a scent that seemed a mixture of wood polish and the ghost of fires long burned out. As he stepped into the room, the soft carpet muffled his footsteps, deepening the silence that enveloped the hall. The dinner hall was a marvel to behold, its magnificence unabated by time. The lofty ceiling was supported by enormous wood beams, and faded tapestries picturing scenes from old Scottish folklore decorated the walls. Scenes of hunting, feasting, and combat, each depicting a tale of glory and conflict, were draped like windows into the past, their vivid threads now subdued by time. At the center of the hall stood a long table made from a single, massive oak tree, polished to a dark sheen by centuries of use. High-backed chairs flanked the table, their seats covered in once rich velvet, now worn to a soft patina. The table was set for one, with fine bone china, a crystal goblet, and gleaming silverware laid out in precise arrangement. The sight was somewhat incongruous, a solitary setting in a hall built to accommodate lavish gatherings and grand feasts. Candles in towering candelabras cast pools of golden light across the table, their flames flickering in the gentle draft that whispered through the room. The light glinted off the silverware and sparked in the facets of the crystal, lending an air of magic to the setting. Above, a grand chandelier hung from the ceiling, its myriad crystals catching the candlelight and scattering it like a shower of stars across the walls and floor. Ethan approached the table, his hand brushing against the back of one of the chairs, feeling the weight of history in its carved oak frame. He imagined the myriad characters who had once gathered around this table. Kilted warriors discussing battle plans, nobles plotting intrigue, and poets finding inspiration in the revelry. The walls seemed to thrum with the echo of laughter and the clink of goblets, the air thick with the aroma of roasted meat and fresh baked bread. As he sat down, the chair creaking slightly under his weight, a servant appeared almost as if summoned by the sound. The young man, dressed in a traditional tartan kilt and a white shirt, carried a tray bearing Ethan's supper, a modest repast consisting of venison stew, freshly baked bread, and a selection of local cheeses. The servant set the tray down with a bow, his demeanor reserved yet friendly. "My name is Hamish," he introduced himself. "Should you need anything during your meal, simply ring the bell by your side." With another respectful nod, Hamish retreated, leaving Ethan to his meal. The stew was hearty and flavorful, rich with the taste of game and root vegetables, and the bread was crusty, perfect for soaking up the broth. As Ethan ate, he let his gaze wander over the tapestries, studying the intricate details. The fierce expression of a hunter, the delicate weave of a noble's gown, the wildness of the highland scenery. Each thread seemed imbued with a story, a snippet of life from a time long gone. Midway through the meal, Ethan's attention was drawn to a particularly vibrant tapestry on the far wall. It depicted a grand feast, not unlike the scene around him, but filled with figures in medieval dress. Intrigued, he rose from his seat and approached the wall for a closer look. The tapestry was a riot of color and activity, with musicians playing in one corner, lords and ladies conversing animatedly, and servants bustling about with trays of food and drink. As he stood before the tapestry, Ethan felt a strange sensation, as if the figures were momentarily alive, their faces turning towards him, eyes glinting with secrets of their era. He could almost hear the music, a distant, haunting melody that seemed to float through the ages. The illusion was momentary, but it left Ethan with a profound sense of connection to the past, a feeling that he was not just a visitor, but a part of the castle's ongoing story. Returning to his seat, Ethan finished his meal in thoughtful silence, pondering the lives of those who had dined in this hall before him. The candlelight flickered, casting shadows that danced across the tapestries, giving them a lifelike quality that made the scenes seem almost in motion. After the meal, Ethan lingered at the table, savoring a glass of rich, peaty Scotch whiskey that Hamish had brought him. The fire in the great hearth at the end of the hall had burned down to embers, casting a warm, comforting glow. Outside, the wind whispered across the loch, a sound that mingled with the soft creaks and settling sounds of the old castle. In that moment, with the shadows of the past flickering around him and the stories of ages woven into the very walls, Ethan felt a deep, resonant peace. Dunmorag was no longer just a structure of stone and wood. It was a living, breathing entity. And for this night, it was his to experience, a page in the long story of his life. Chapter 3, The Ghost of the Laird. The chill of the stone corridor wrapped itself around Ethan as he ventured out of the banquet hall, his footsteps echoing in the cavernous passages of Dunmorag Castle. The candles that lined the walls cast flickering shadows, giving the ancient stone an ethereal glow that seemed to pulse with the life of centuries past. With the tales of the old laird, Sir Andrew McLean, fresh in his mind, Ethan's curiosity pulled him deeper into the castle's heart. He was lured to the castle's vast library as he made his way through the maze-like corridors. He pushed open the massive wooden door, which creaked menacingly, to see a large room filled with bookshelves that reached the ceiling. The air was heavy with the musty smell of old leather and paper, a monument to the generations of MacLeans who had amassed secrets and knowledge behind these walls. As Ethan stepped inside, the temperature seemed to drop, a coldness that seeped into his bones despite the warmth of the whiskey he had enjoyed earlier. He shivered, his breath visible in the air, and wondered if the castle's heating had failed, or if the ghost of Sir Andrew was making his presence known. In the dim light provided by a single hanging lamp, Ethan's eyes were drawn to a large painting that dominated one wall of the library. It was a portrait of Sir Andrew McLean, the laird who was said to still haunt this castle. The painting was striking. Sir Andrew was depicted in full Highland regalia, his expression stern and commanding, his eyes sharp and piercing. Those eyes, Ethan noticed with a shiver, seemed to follow him as he moved across the room. Underneath the painting, a small brass plaque recounted Sir Andrew's legacy, his bravery in battle, his wisdom in leadership, and his tragic death in the very room in which Ethan now stood. It was rumored that Sir Andrew's spirit was unable to rest, forever searching the castle for the lost treasure he'd hidden from rival clans. Feeling a mix of apprehension and thrill, Ethan approached the massive oak desk that sat beneath the portrait. It was cluttered with ancient manuscripts and faded maps that hinted at forgotten passages and hidden rooms. As he ran his fingers over the cool, smooth surface of the desk, he heard a soft thud behind him. Whirling around, his heart pounding, he saw that a book had fallen to the floor from one of the shelves. Hesitantly, Ethan picked up the book. It was an old ledger, the leather cover cracked and worn. Opening it, he found entries in a neat script detailing the castle's expenses from centuries ago. As he flipped through the pages, a folded piece of parchment fell out. It was a map, crudely drawn, showing a section of the castle not covered in his initial tour. A red X marked a specific spot in what appeared to be the old tower. Compelled by a mix of curiosity and an unexplainable pull, Ethan tucked the map into his jacket and left the library, his footsteps quickening as he headed toward the tower. The corridors seemed even darker now, the shadows deeper. A cold draft whispered through the halls, carrying with it faint whispers that Ethan strained to understand, but they slipped away just as he thought he might grasp them. As he climbed the narrow, spiraling staircase to the tower, the air grew colder, and the feeling of being watched intensified. Reaching the top, Ethan found himself in a small, circular room with a single window overlooking the loch. The moon cast a silver glow, illuminating the room enough for him to see a heavy tapestry covering part of the wall. Remembering the map, Ethan approached the tapestry and, with a deep breath, pulled it aside. Behind it, he discovered a door, old and almost completely camouflaged within the stone wall. It took several attempts to open it, the hinges protesting with a loud creak that echoed ominously through the tower. Inside, Ethan found a small, hidden chamber. Dust motes danced in the beam of his flashlight, and his breath came out in visible puffs of white. The room was empty, save for a large, iron-bound chest in the center. Heart racing, he approached it, the air around him thick with the sense of imminent discovery. With trembling hands, he opened the chest. Inside, wrapped in a faded tartan cloth, was a collection of items. A rusted broadsword, several gold coins, and a jeweled brooch. These were the treasures Sir Andrew had hidden, the legacy of a laird that had been lost in time until now. As Ethan stood there, the weight of history palpable in the cold air of the hidden chamber, he felt a sudden warmth, as if the room had suddenly been filled with the presence of Sir Andrew himself. A voice, deep and resonant, filled the chamber, whispering in Gaelic. Though Ethan didn't understand the words, he felt a profound sense of peace and an unspoken approval. With the ghost of Sir Andrew seemingly at rest, having led him to this long hidden treasure, Ethan carefully replaced the items and left the chamber, resealing the door behind him. As he descended the tower, the air gradually warmed, and the feeling of being watched dissipated. The castle, with its deep history and ancient secrets, had opened up its heart to him, bridging the gap between the past and the present in one unforgettable night. Chapter 4. Dawn in the Highlands. After a night of whispers and wandering spirits, Ethan found himself drawn to the highest tower of Dunmorag Castle as the first hints of dawn crept across the Scottish Highlands. The air was crisp, a delicate balance of the night shadows and the day's promise, and the world around him was hushed as if in reverence to the transition of time. Climbing the narrow spiral staircase to the tower's viewing platform, Ethan's thoughts were a tangle of the night's discoveries and the silent stories whispered by the ancient stones. Each step took him further from the realm of specters and closer to the tangible, yet still mystical, world of the living Highlands. The final step onto the platform brought him into a new atmosphere, one where the air was tinged with the scent of dew-soaked heather and the distant salt of the sea. As he reached the tower's summit, the horizon was just beginning to illuminate, the dark indigo of the night sky melting into a tapestry of deep blues and warm, glowing ambers. Below, the loch reflected the evolving sky, its surface a mirror to the heaven's hues. The rolling hills and sprawling moors of the Highlands unfolded in waves of shadow and light, ancient and unchanged, bearing witness to the passage of time, both human and celestial. Ethan leaned against the cool stone battlement, feeling the rough texture against his palms, grounding him in the moment. From this vantage point, the world seemed boundless, and he was a solitary figure caught between the vastness of land and sky. The air was filled with the sounds of awakening, the distant calls of waking birds, the rustle of small creatures in the bracken, and the whispering breeze that danced through the tower's crevices. The sun, in its majestic indifference to mortal affairs, crowned the horizon in a blaze of gold and crimson, rays of light pierced the morning mist, casting beams that stretched across the land like the fingers of gods, old and new. The castle's shadow grew long, then quickly receded, as if pulling back into the stone from whence it came. Standing there, Ethan felt a profound connection to the land and its history. It was as if the dawn did not just bring light, but also wove the fabric of time, stitching past to present with golden threads. Here, in the raw beauty of the highlands, the legends of old didn't feel so distant, and the spirits that roamed the night seemed as natural as the light that now bathed the land. Below, the castle lay quiet, its presence a stark silhouette against the lightning sky, a keeper of secrets and a sanctuary from the modern world. Ethan imagined the generations of those who had watched similar sunrises from this very spot, each with their own hopes, fears, and stories. He wondered about Sir Andrew McLean, whose restless spirit had led him to a hidden treasure not of gold, but of connection to the rich tapestry of Scottish lore. As the sun climbed higher, the colors of the dawn began to soften, the spectacular display fading into the light blue of morning. The magic of the sunrise slowly gave way to the ordinary beauty of a new day, and Ethan felt a gentle closure to the nocturnal chapter of his adventure. There was a sense of fulfillment, a silent acknowledgement from the universe that he had witnessed something extraordinary, a moment shared across time with all who had come before and all who would follow. Reluctantly, Ethan finally turned away from the parapet, feeling the weight of history in his bones, but a lightness in his spirit. As he made his way back down the spiral staircase, the echoes of his footsteps were a solitary, but not lonely sound. The castle was waking up, the stone warming to the touch of the sun, and the air clearing the last vestiges of the night's mysteries. Mr. MacGregor was waiting for him at the base of the tower, a knowing smile on his weather-beaten face. "You've seen it then, the dawn of the highlands," he said, his voice a warm rumble. "It's something you never forget." Ethan nodded, unable to articulate the fullness of his experience. The castle keeper clapped him on the shoulder, a solid, affirming gesture that spoke of understanding. As Ethan left Dunmorag Castle, the morning light escorted him down the winding road that led away from the ancient fortress. He carried with him not just photographs or souvenirs, but a deep-seated feeling of having touched something eternal. The castle, with its ghosts and treasures, had given him far more than a night's lodging. It had gifted him a timeless connection to the mystic allure of the Scottish Highlands, a memory to cherish as he rejoined the world beyond the castle walls.